Oh, it's live on Facebook, is that?
Yay!
Yay!
Yay! Made it.
Hey. Oh, we're finally on. Oh my God. Hello, everyone. I'm Hunter Foster. I'm the artistic director here at the Red House. And we want to welcome you to our Red Talks, which happens every Tuesday at 5:30. And we talk everything theater. We talk everything we do at Red House. And we're going to do it every Tuesday. And so tonight we have some special guests, some Red House favorites, a lot of people who have worked with us for many years and done shows and taught for us. And we just want to introduce these our special guests, a great bunch of people. Gretchen Martino. Hey, Gretchen.
Hello.
Stephfond Brunson.
Hey.
Hey, Stephfond. Jason Timothy.
Hello.
Carlos Garcia-Soto.
Hey. That's me.
And our education director, Peggy Mitchell.
Hello.
Thanks so much for joining us, guys. This is obviously education is a big part of what we do here at Red House, and so we thought we would devote one of our Red Talks to that. And so without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Peggy, who's our education director, to ask you guys some questions.
Yeah, so many of you guys did different forms of teaching artistry with Red House. So Gretchen was a part of our summer camps and was a teacher in one of our SESD schools. Carlos has taught summer camps. He's been in the school district partnership. He's also been a part of the Arcabana Doga show last year, Once Upon a Mattress. Stephfond has done many, many, many things, taught in various schools, various summer camps, and he's choreographed a lot of the shows, and now he's our artistic associate. And then Jason is probably one of our longest standing members of, you've been a part of the ARC partnership for almost the last like 6 years. As a mentor and a teaching artist. And so my first question that I want to turn over to you guys is just talking a little bit about your experiences with Red House and what arts education means to you. What does it mean to you to be a teaching artist for Red House?
I'll go first.
Yes.
So as Hunter and Peggy mentioned, I'm a performer as well as an educator, and working with the Red House Education Department, especially in the city schools here in Syracuse, have just been really eye-opening to the ways that arts education can change lives. I worked with elementary students, so preschool through fifth grade, and students who either have very limited access to the arts or maybe they do know a little bit, just watching them get to create and explore with their classmates and their instructors, it's just a beautiful thing, and it's something that the Syracuse City School District is really lucky to have.
Going for what Gretchen was saying, hello, my name is Carlo again. Me working also at the Syracuse School District, I work at Seymour and I also work at Blodgett, and being able to give back to the student. I come from the same neighborhood as them. So being able to say, you can make it in different ways. You don't have to do just one thing. For example, when you doing art, you can express yourself. Sometimes the kids didn't even know how to express themselves, but just with anger. So when you give them that platform of, you can dance, you can draw, you can act, they'll be like, oh my God, can I do that? Yes, you can, honey. So I think I'm grateful to be part of Red House and being able to provide for that for the kids. And that is a wonderful thing that I will never forget.
I would say that I started out as one of Peggy's first hires. She asked me to do a summer camp and teach little actors. And just the joy when you walk into that room and these kids are just like sponges. They just want to learn and they want to learn all about the arts. And we had a couple of weeks and, you know, just to put a whole show together. And then I was just like hooked because these kids, and it's, you know, you're really realizing that you're in a, you know, educational theater, you know.
I don't have a good answer because I can't say that I consider myself a teaching artist. I consider myself a learning artist. Every time I have the opportunity to work with ARC, I'm sure I accidentally teach probably some bad habits along the way. But I think that what I learn and what I get from it is so much more than anything I could possibly give, which is why I keep coming back. I get so much joy and so much personal fulfillment out of that whole experience that it's literally what I look forward to most every year.
Jason, what would you say your most memorable moment has been? I mean, you've been with us for so long and you've done so many productions as part of the ARC partnership. What would be like the most memorable moment to you that you were like, this is why I want to keep coming back. This is why I want to do this.
So generally speaking, a moment that's memorable every year is the first meeting / rehearsal. When we all get back in the room together, there's just so much excitement and these people that we haven't seen for, you know, some of them we haven't seen for a year, some of them we haven't seen for a week. And you get all of those people back in the room and it's just so positive and joyous and full of love. So that, very generally speaking. Very specifically speaking, one of my favorite memories is, I think it was during Once Upon a Mattress, I'm not even sure. But we were filming videos with mentors and ARC folks. And the process of filming an interview with Derek, one of my buddies from the show, was probably the most fun I've had off the stage during an ARC show. So that was a lot of fun.
So Gretchen and Carlos, you guys were in the schools this past year. What would you say your most memorable moment was as a teacher, as an artist in the school district?
I feel like, I mean, the days when we have their share performance, their end of the quarter performances are always just such a magical time because seeing the kids get up on stage and share what they've been learning is just beautiful. But probably my favorite moment was actually last year. I was teaching a Shakespeare unit and I had one of my students walking through the audience, going up to like parents and teachers and other students, trying to explain what the play was about and what her character did and what all the other characters in the play did. So something as difficult as Shakespeare, having a second grader, walk around and be able to explain and be so excited to share what she had learned about Shakespeare. And we were doing A Midsummer Night's Dream and just her lighting up and being like, do you know the story? Well, I do. Let me tell you about it. So that was a beautiful, beautiful day.
That's amazing. For me, I will say I have a lot of great memories, but I know last year, one of my eighth graders, when I was teaching a Blodgett, she was going through a lot with self-esteem, and that was like a huge impact on her. But the way she glowed after we have, after she was able to express herself through dance, through acting, it was, for me, it was like, oh my God, when I first met you, your self-esteem and your soul, she was so down. And when I left her, honey, she was conquering your world. She was like, yes, I'm here. And I was like, that is what I want to do. If I did that, for me, I'm happy. And I think that was the most amazing thing that I have been able to see grow for like a couple months. And that was amazing. I'm like, yes, girl, live your life.
I know, Stephon, you've told me many, many, many stories. What would you say that your most memorable favorite memory was about teaching the kids in the school district or working with them as part of summer camps, as a choreographer?
I have two, but my, one of them that still gets me like a little bit like emotional. I was working in a pre-K class with a kid who was nonverbal named Amir. He was 6 years old. And every day I would come in singing from Sound of Music. I was like, doe, a deer, a female deer. And one day I had my iPad open and I was just singing with him and he started singing the song. And I was like, what's your name? He goes, Amir. And I have it on camera, it was on camera, my heart stopped. And then everyone from the school I was teaching at Porter, they were running down going, how did you get him to talk? How did you get him to speak? I was like, that's just the power of the arts, you know? power of good old, you know, Julie Andrews, you know, singing everything. And my second one was I was choreographing Hairspray, and we were working with Hillside Family of Agencies, and we had this girl in the show named Jamie Rains, and she was playing one of the dynamites. And she was so afraid. She wouldn't, like, she didn't want to, like, open her mouth or speak. And then she just started singing. I was like, where did that voice come from? And she was like, well, I didn't know I had it in there. And I was like, yes, you do. You have it in there. And this girl has moved on and, like, you know, graduated from SU with a degree in fashion. And it's just, you know, that's the, as I'm always going to say, it's just the power of the arts.
Which leads me to my next question for everyone, because there arts can be so transformative. And when you're working with, I feel like people are just so inherently creative, that it's a part of who we are, that, you know, each one of you have had experiences where you have worked with individuals who might not see themselves as creative beings when you first start working with them. And I know for me, that's why I feel that arts is so transformative. And so the question that I have for you guys is, you know, in your work with Redhouse or other places, kind of what your perspective is on the arts and the transformative power that is the arts.
I had a student this year and last year, and all last year, he refused to get on stage for the final performance. In class, he participated. We never had an issue with participation, but when it came time to the performance day, he would kind of get closed off and get upset and say, I can't do it, I'm not doing it. And this year, after having spent a whole year with him last year, this year I, you know, talked with him and tried to figure out what exactly was causing the nerves and this and that. And he ended up telling me, like, well, I just don't think I'm good enough. I don't think that I'm talented enough. Like, I'm watching these performances and, you know, I see a lot of talented people and I just don't think I'm talented enough. And we obviously had a conversation about that, and I helped him, at least I hope I did, discover the things that he found to be strengths. And he was like, I'm an actor. I know I'm not a singer. I know I'm not a dancer, but I think I could be a good actor. So I was like, great, let's get you a part where maybe you have some more speaking lines. And he went on stage for the first time this year. And the first thing he said when he came off was, I did it. And it was just the first time he ever went on stage. He was in fifth grade, so he's been doing Redhouse for years. And yeah, just being able to acknowledge what his strengths were and be able to share that was transformative, for sure.
So I shared a dressing room during Once Upon a Mattress with somebody on this panel. I hope everybody are in the same order as my faces. And he just kept the whole time saying, you know, but this isn't what I do. You know, I'm a teacher. I belong in the classroom. I don't belong on the stage. Every single scene this, I'm not going to call names, but every single scene this person was in, they stole the scene. But I think, you know, everybody thinks, we all see somebody else doing their work. And everybody thinks, oh, that person's so great. That person does this. That person brings that. We're not always the best at knowing what it is that we bring to the table. And I think that's what's really great about theater specifically, is that you can put somebody on the stage and discover things about them that they didn't even know about themselves. Mm-hmm. And especially, I think that's especially true in the art show, because it tends to be a situation where it's so much about the process. And, you know, we have this amazing culture in the rehearsals, and, you know, you get to performance time and there's some people that, you know, did their job in rehearsal, but all of a sudden they blossom when there's an audience. And it's just fun to see, you know, people discovering the artist within, especially when they didn't suspect that person was there themselves.
My biggest thing is, it's like, I'm going to just jump off what Jason said. The discovery is just watching these kids just discover who they are. And just when you're like, okay, we're going to do a Shakespeare unit, and they're like, who's this Hamlet guy? And then you do the whole unit, and then they're like, oh, okay, I want to be an actor and get on stage and just do that. I was like, well, you can, you know, never say no, you can do it. And that's transformative for me, just watching them, just knowing that they can find the discoveries in anything.
So you're a very established local choreographer and teaching artist, and you've been working with various different theaters around Central New York. So have you ever had a moment that sticks out in your mind where it was transformative for you, or you felt like maybe you couldn't do it? And
every day of my life, there's always points when I'm like choreographing where I'm like, I should just hang it up. I shouldn't do this. And then you watch that dance number happen and you're like, okay, I got this. I can do that. And many of the companies, I always do that. I have that second guess of myself.
So I know that Gretchen and Jason both participated also in various new works that happened over the last year. So part of our New Works Festival, it's an artistic program that we have, but it's also educational in a lot of ways. It's educational for the writers, the directors, for us as producers, for the actors. And so I kind of jointly want to ask you guys a couple of questions about the New Works process as well and what that was like. So Gretchen, what New Works were you in? You were in Bisland and Bly.
I was.
Right? And Jason, you were in Girl in the Red Dress.
And Bisland and Bly.
And Bisland and Bly, yeah. Yes.
Yep.
So what were those experiences like for you, can you speak a little bit about what that was like working on something that was a completely new work that had never been done before in front of an audience?
It's like one of my favorite artistic experiences to date in my life. It was, I mean, working on something that no one else can say that they've done this on stage and sang through this music and worked with these writers. It's just such a unique experience, and it's a quick experience. So what did we rehearse for? A week and a half? And then, yeah. Was that it? Yeah. So we rehearsed for a week and a half and then put on two productions of it, and two or three, two?
Two
productions of it. And just even in such a short amount of time, there is so much discovery within the piece. It was just a one of a kind experience, and I cherished every minute of it and would do it again in a heartbeat.
I agree. I mean, the two that I worked on were very different experiences. Bisland and Bly was a slightly longer process, and we did a little more staging with that one. So there was a lot of exploring the physicality of the piece, which was something we did not get to do. But it was important, I think, in Bisland and Bly because of the nature of the way the story was told. There had to be a visual element that was manifest through the staging. Girl in the Red Dress was a little different because we spent a lot of time around the table working on that show. And Hunter actually spent a lot of time figuring out how to make the story work. And I'll say that my favorite thing about that experience was, I ended up playing a character that was different than the one that I was on day one. And a lot of the songs changed. The piece that we kind of started with at the first reading was so different from what that audience got to see. But my favorite moment there was when one of the songwriters took me out into the lobby and played a brand new song and was like, so, you know, we wrote this last night, you're going to sing it, you know, in act two. So this is the song. And I was like, oh my God, this is the kind of experience that, you know, people have like once in a lifetime, you know, where they, you know, Stephen Sondheim wrote a song and they listened to it. But in a really unique and special way, this was kind of that moment for me. And Peggy, as you know, I fell in love with the songwriters for Girl in the Red Dress. And we went on a little road trip actually to see Maya perform over the summer. So it was a very, very special experience that I don't think I will ever replicate both shows.
Yeah, we were very lucky to have someone of Maya's caliber come and be with us. And to learn so much about her music and how gifted she is as a songwriter. She actually, I don't know if you, Jason, you know, she had coronavirus.
Yeah.
And she survived and got through it. Yeah, she was, so that was a bit scary, but she got through it and she's also healthy. Buddy
also was brilliant to work with too. I mean, the two of them really.
Yeah, and it was those 2 weeks were pretty, much different from watching Bizzle and Bly or Trophy Room, which was the other show we did, because we were literally spent majority of the time around the table. And I think Peggy didn't have a song, and then we gave Peggy a song, and then we took the song away from Peggy. We were just like, and you know, every night afterwards we'd sit and just like put note cards, and I feel so bad, but we were moving things around, but we were, you know, the most important thing was to try to make sure the writers came away with something that they felt like it improved their show, which I think it did. But it was great to have everyone's input. And that was my first chance to sort of work with the local actors in Syracuse. And it was great to see we had such a large talent pool of people who are committed and wanted to create. So.
Well, and that's why I brought it up as part of the arts education Red Talk, is because, you know, from being a part of Girl in the Red Dress, it made the cast, it seemed very much like what we try to create in our classrooms, or what I've seen Stephfond or Carlos or Gretchen create in their classrooms, is you're creating this end product and you're really doing it as a cohesive group. You know, so you were given the song, and then I was given a song. I had to learn it really fast, but then they decided a different character was going to sing that song. And so the girl who got the song afterwards, she and I were in the corner, like going through it together. And it really was just something that brought everybody together to create this thing. And that's really what I think is most beautiful about a lot of the work that you guys do with Redhouse and with other places, is, you know, bringing people together in really collaborative ways. I'm on the topic of Newark, so I kind of have a question for Hunter about what that Newark's process was like for you, as kind of having to wear several hats.
It's a lot sometimes, because you're trying to, you get this, like you get something and someone sends something to you, and people send stuff to me all the time. And I knew that the script needed work. And sometimes you don't know how much the script needs work until you actually have it read out loud. I knew I loved the music. And so I was like, her songwriting is so good, and these songs are so good. We'll figure it out when we get there. And we got there and we started opening things up, and then I would say it's like pulling on a sweater. And so when the thread on the sweater, and then the whole sweater starts to fall apart. And so like you take out one thing and that affects something else. And I think it was Aubrey. I think we went that the song, we went through three different people is the song. And so, right. It started off with Stephanie, then it went to Peggy, and then it went to Aubrey. So, you know, you're basically taking these songs and moving them around, but it affects everything. So it was just like this, trying to balance it all out. And then you don't have, like, we could have spent 6 weeks trying to figure all that stuff out. And then we knew we had to do performances. We were doing two performances. So then you had to get it in some sort of shape to present it. But, you know, I thought that it was, and sometimes you feel, there were moments where I was like, oh my God, we've made a mess. We've taken the car apart, and there's just car pieces everywhere, and we don't know where the car pieces go back to make the, you know, when you're taking apart something, and you're literally like, there were moments I was looking at going, oh my God, there's no way we're going to get this back together, going to make sense. But, you know, they worked, what was great is the cast worked really hard, but the writers worked really hard as well. They drank a lot of wine, stayed up, had late nights, and would come back in with totally new material. I think we had a script a night. We would call everyone back in, we'd sit around the table, and then we'd read a new script. And then my favorite part was just watching all the actors' faces of being like, trying to figure it out. So, you know, it's that part's fun. I love that. I love doing that. And I know I don't think Bizlin changed as much as Red Dress, yeah, right?
We have not too many changes. And the changes that happened were small, relatively.
Yeah. And then I think Trophy Room was our other show. So no one was in it from here, but Trophy Room was our other. So we did two new works, we did a play and a musical, and we did Trophy Room. And one night we had an intermission, and the next night we didn't have an intermission. And so, and sometimes you just experiment, you know, like I said, if you could do a lot of these, you would experiment and see what works, what doesn't work. I'm not sure if we, because we did one performance or two performances of Red Dress. I can't remember. Was it two?
No, just one.
One. Yeah, because we could have learned. I know that with even with Bislin, I think they made a, or they were, did they make, they made a few changes the next night for Bislin. So that's the thing, is you can learn from an audience and they'll tell you stuff and then you can make changes. So yeah.
Yeah. And I know, Carlos, you did, you taught as part of our after school program.
Yes.
And you were prepping to put on a really unique version of Once on This Island with your kids. And I know that you were going through very similar things.
Yes.
As the director of that show. So what was that like? Taking a show that already exists and in an educational setting, they were like, the licensing company was like, you can, you know, it's for educational purposes. We really want this to be a something that is a learning process for everyone. So you were allowed to make some changes. And I remember seeing you going through that process. So what was that like? What changes were you making and why?
Well, I was like, oh my God, what am I doing? First of all, I'm like, oh my God, I don't know how to do this. But then, because when I read that we have done this the play before at Seymour at the elementary, and I was like, I love this play, we have to do it. And what I was thinking of doing is because Once on This Island, two islands, two different worlds. So I'm like, let me include that into my country. So I was thinking Dominican Republic and Haiti is one country per se, but it's separated. So that was my mentality, because right now Dominican Republic and Haiti, they are going through this battle of, and I know I can say these Dominicans are very discriminatory towards the Haitian. And I wanted to include that into the show, because I also believe that the kids, since they're like Hispanic, they will understand what I'm trying to say. And they did, which is why I was like, I have to push for this. I need to do it like this, because the way that the play was written, the kids were not really buying it per se, but when I swayed it this way, I'm like, hey, Dominican Republic and Haiti, but oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. So I also, that was like, I need to do it like this. And, but it was challenging for me to even make those changes, because that was my first time me being, okay, let me make this change and not go through the play itself. But it was fun, and the kids loved it. I wish we could have done the play. It would have been amazing.
They can't perform. That's why I bring it up too. They can't perform it right now because of the schools being on hiatus.
But it was a good time. It was a good moment. And I'm pretty sure the kids, they will never forget the process that we were doing to make that happen.
Great. So how are you guys staying creative during all of this?
You don't want to know. Okay.
Oh, I've seen the videos, Donnie.
I mean, I was saying to somebody the other day that, you know, typically in times of trial, during wars, during things like this, you know, artists tend to kind of dig in and rise above and get really creative. And so I'm just wondering, kind of like as teaching artists, as performers, as artists, some things, whether they're very seriously career driven or even silly, some things that you guys are doing to stay creative during this time.
Well Redhouse. Oh, go ahead, Stephfond.
Oh, no, you can go.
Oh, I was going to say, shameless Redhouse plug is that you guys are doing those classes. So I participated in the monologue workshop with Hunter. I'm doing the Shakespeare one tomorrow, and next week is the contemporary scene study. So those are like a really great creative thing to look forward to. I also, I worked for a Shakespeare company in Buffalo, Shakespeare in Delaware Park, and they've started this Touchstone Book Club, where a bunch of people read a play and then we talk about it on the Facebook group, and we have Zoom meetings to discuss it. So definitely reading a lot, and just finding any way I can with these classes are a great opportunity to keep my artistic juices flowing, and reading for sure.
I've been working on my improv skills by acting surprised every time an Amazon package arrives. And I don't know. I don't remember ordering that.
I have been, if you are like quarantined in a house with your significant other, you are learning new things. And my husband and I decide that we're just going to make funny videos, or our life has become an HGTV show, because every other day he's like redoing a room. So that's been a lot of fun. So I go in there, I think he's redoing a room right now. So that should be really fun when I open the door.
Well, for me, I have been trying to start my own YouTube channel. Stay tuned. So that's what I've been thinking of doing for years. And I'm like, it's my time now to shine. So that's what I'm thinking right now. I'm like browsing through ideas of exactly what I want to do. But stay tuned. It's going to be fun.
Oh, I'm subscribing to that.
That's great.
Yeah?
Nope. You there, Peg?
Oh, did I freeze?
Oh, maybe.
Oh, no, I'm here.
Okay.
I froze for a second, but I'm back. Yeah, so I'm new at this, Hunter. Do we do a Q&A section?
Yeah, we got a Q&A, and I got it all set up so people can ask questions right now. Ooh. This is only the second time that we've done this, and so we're still trying to figure it out. We've got music, anyone out there who I know a lot of people have been writing comments and they've been saying some stuff. So a lot of our friends out there, if anyone would like to ask these guys a question, please go ahead. Anyone? I'm waiting. Bill Hyder's watching.
Hi, Mike, Bill.
Mike Cadero.
Hi, Mike. Mike is also an amazing teacher, by the way.
Big facts.
I'm gonna go through some of these. Allison Whitehurst, Dalcy Van D, Greg Halpin, Robert Edwards.
Oh, Robert.
Oh, Greg Halpin. Hi, Greg.
Karen Dunn.
Hi, Karen.
Allison.
Hi, Allison. So, send me some questions. Just type them and say and anything you want to know. We're waiting. I'm gonna put who's zooming who on again. Oh, okay. From Patricia. Oh God, I can't pronounce his last name.
Kachuni.
Yeah.
Oh, Pacuni.
Pacuni.
Is it?
Yeah.
Yes. What have you been binge watching, and how much did you love the Sondheim concert?
Okay. First of all, Sondheim concert. Who volunteers to sing with Audra? I mean, I know. Who says, yeah, I'll sing with Audra? That's ridiculous, number one.
That's why they were all pouring giant glasses of wine.
Yeah, and love the montage at the end and picking out everybody I knew in the little boxes was so fun. Binge watching Ozark, holy goodness. I just finished season 3, was not prepared for how that was gonna go down. I'll be talking about it in therapy for quite a while.
That's been recommended to me, but I haven't watched it yet.
So good.
I've been rewatching Friends for the 18th time. Oh, don't judge.
Amazing. Live your life, honey.
It makes you feel good though, right? About life. You're just like when you watch Friends.
Exactly. Exactly.
I mean, I rewatched The Office about like 8 times. So
I'm at 2 so far with The Office, 2 times.
Donnie and I are like watching like 80s and 90s movies. So last night we watched The War of the Roses, and you should never watch that with
no
person that you
Carlos, what have you been binge watching?
I have been in my house. We have these Latinos, so we don't have American channels. Sorry. So so I've been watching this show called El Chavo. It's like this comedy from the 90s from Mexico. It's hilarious. I always watch it since I was little. And I'm like, I record it and then I watch it again. And then record it and watch it again. It's been fun. But yeah, the only show that we have in English, I think, is CNN. Everything else is in Spanish. And that's why my accents keep getting thicker and thicker.
Yeah. A lot of funny stuff to watch on CNN.
CNN.
I'm like, let me not watch that. Let me go to Spanish.
anyone else out there want to give us, Jennifer Cody's watching. Jennifer, give a question.
Hi, Jen.
I don't know where she's watching from. a secure location. Allison Macri, you're on. Do you have any questions for our group? Jordan Hagen.
Jordan.
Hey, Jordan.
Hey, Jordan.
Any questions? Well, I mean, people already know so much about you. Maybe they don't have questions. Patricia says, watching The Office right now, and she loves The Office Ladies podcast, and she misses you all. Allison misses us all. Jennifer Cody, is anyone taking classes online like Zumba?
I'm doing yoga.
No. That's a good idea.
Some yoga every day online.
Me too. I do yoga through, because we have a yoga studio downstairs, Oh Yoga. So I take their class every day, except I'm usually like the only guy in the class, and I have I don't put the camera on me, so I have like a picture, but it's a really sort of creepy picture. So I know that they're probably like, who's the creepy guy who never has his camera on? So anyway. Is there anything I can do, Brandon Lee, is there anything I can do from home to become a better performing artist?
That's a good question.
That is a good question.
Now is a good time to soak up the arts because they're so accessible right now. Yeah. So people are streaming. You've got virtual Red House with classes, like, hello, great way to become a better performing artist. But I say just soak up as much as you can. I mean, this is a great time. We don't have any excuse. You know, you can, their Broadway HD is great and fairly inexpensive, free trial. But there's a lot of really great art still out there that we can consume. And I think not only is that good for us as performers, it's just good for us as people.
I told the Mono class the other night and some of the teens to start reading plays, musicals. Like, you know, if you don't know, there's a bunch of plays. I'm like, God, I haven't read it in years, or I forgot about it. So I just got a ton of plays that we had at Red House. I brought them
a shelf of plays.
Yeah.
Get yourself up on things that you may have never read.
My dad said he's watching The Best Thing right now. Woo, woo. Thanks, Dad.
There you go. Studio 44 Wellness offers bar, dance, drum, live drumming, this is Toby Sheck, and life classes.
Check, I have done a bar class. They kick your butt.
Yeah.
Luckily, I've been able to do that.
It's fun, though. It is fun.
Does anyone have any questions about stuff that the future? I mean, we're on Zoom meetings every single day, trying to figure out what our future is going to be. We're talking to other theaters around the country, both with how education is going to work and how main stage is going to work. So we're actively trying to figure this out, and it changes daily. But we do have a lot of great plans, I think, that we're working on, you know, that I think is hopefully we'll be able to announce sometime soon. But we have definitely working every single day and trying, how do we adapt in the new environment, and an environment that may stay this way for a while, and we're gonna adapt to it. And we're gonna figure it out.
Yeah. And in a lot of ways, you know, whenever there's a challenge, you know, it just kind of inspires creativity. And so I think that, you know, even with everything going on, you know, that the challenges posed in front of us will just make us a more creative Red House.
Yeah, absolutely. Mookie's on. Hey, Mookie.
Mookie. I love Mookie.
Any other questions out there that you guys want to ask? We have 21 people on right now.
Yes, I do.
All right. Aside from theater, which small businesses do you support?
Food.
I mean.
Well, we can't support the bar. I mean, they're liquor stores anymore than we have been. So, I think any place where people can gather.
Yeah. Well, I know one of the things that I've been doing is that, you know, whenever we do want to order out, making sure you order from someone who is a local business.
Yeah. And
Yep. That
being extremely important, because you buying those just couple of items goes such a long way for all the people working at that place.
Yeah.
We have a question. What is everyone's dream role?
Oh.
Oh.
Question, you go first.
Mine would be Cassie in A Chorus Line.
Don't pop the head, Cassie.
Stephfond, you next. You guys had the biggest reaction. So Stephfond.
Oh, this is so against type, I think, for just because people just don't want to think that of me as Don Quixote. Oh. Man of La Mancha. Yeah.
Yeah.
I love That'll be 2024 season. We'll put that in there.
Right.
Okay. I want to play anybody in The Prom. Like any of those roles, I would happily play. Yeah.
For me, I would like to play Daniel from What's on This Island by the game. Oh, no, let's switch this up. You know. Let me be the prince, but let me be gay and be the prince.
There you go. Okay.
What do you quibby?
What does that mean?
I don't know what quibby is. I know quibby is something we should know. Isn't I don't know. It's
like an online.
What is a quibby? I'm already afraid.
Are we talking about this? TV.
Isn't it like TV on your phone? Is that what it is?
Oh, it's like those 10 minute like TV shows. I think that's what it is.
I'm not trendy enough to know what that is. Gretchen, do you know what that is?
You think I'm trendy? I don't know. Yeah.
I don't speak English, so I don't
speak English.
Jason's probably looking it up right now.
Bruce Grogan is on. Is that Haley's dad?
Yes, it is.
Oh my God. Yadisa said they're like mini episodes.
Oh.
Yadisa. Well, mini episodes of what?
Of just anything?
Of anything, I think.
Okay.
Can we just talk about Haley Grogan for a second?
All the time.
Yes, we should could talk about Haley Grogan.
Haley Grogan is from Rochester. She is the
Star.
A star. Because she may be watching if her dad's on. We love Haley. Haley was in Christmas Carol, and she's quite a character. She's a Elaine Stritch in a 9-year-old body, and she. She was such a trooper. We were doing a matinee of Christmas Carol and she hurt herself and she troopered through and kept doing the show, even though we were worried about her. And she said, it's not about the pain. It's about my future in acting. She was afraid that her future in acting was going to be affected, but she kept going.
She was such a trooper that those of us in the cast on stage with her had no idea she had hurt herself. She didn't even let on.
No, no. And she chipped her tooth. And she got it fixed and she looks great. Oh, Ben Mexel is watching.
Oh, Ben.
Ben from our camps.
So Ben was our music director for Into the Woods over the summer, last past summer, yep. With the students.
Ben was excellent. He's also from Rochester. We love our Rochester people. Please come up to Syracuse. Great. Any other questions you have, Peggy, for anyone? No? Okay. All right. Anything else you guys want to talk about or say before
I do want to share something.
Great.
You know, I just wish you guys, first of all, keep it fabulous, period. Stay healthy, stay blessed, always live your life, even if at your house, and don't let nobody push you down. When this situation happening in the world, always push it, always keep it pushing. Like my mom always say, honey, keep it pushing, keep it pushing, keep it pushing, because we will prevail and we're gonna be fabulous at the end of the day. Yeah. And wash your hands.
Yeah, I second that. You know, we got to stay positive. And, you know, a lot of people are working really hard to sort of, you know, get us back to hopefully a war. And it may be different, but like Peggy said, you have challenges and you it may open up other doors to other things. And so we're excited about the future and we're definitely will be back. I know we will.
Can't wait.
All right. Well, thank you so much, guys. We miss you all, and we thank you for being a part of Redhouse. On our way out, I'm going to, on our way out, you get fabulous prizes.
Prizes.
You get a dollar. You get a dollar.
No, but I am going to play for Maya Sharp. I am going to play a little bit of a song from that she wrote that's from Girl in Red Dress, just because I think she's an incredible artist and a COVID survivor. So thanks, everyone, for watching. Please be safe. And as Carlos said, wash your hands. And we'll see you next Tuesday. Wednesday. And we'll have two special guests, actually, which we can confirm will be here next week. Fred Grandy and Ted Lange. And some special guests from Love Boat will be here next Tuesday at 5:30. All right. Have a great night. Thank you so much, everyone.
Bye, everyone.
Gracias. Nos vemos.
All right.
This place, here conformity's king. They'll wipe that smile right off your face, give you a list of songs you're allowed to sing. La 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 la. Yeah, you can say what's on your mind, as long as it's on the